Since their introduction, the Challenger Hellcat and the Charger Hellcat that we're looking at today have gone from freakishly powerful curiosity to arguably performance legends, or perhaps even performance icons in America. But as with every legend out there, there are certainly some stretched truths, some conventional wisdoms that are right, and some conventional wisdoms that are wrong about the Hellcat Charger and the Hellcat Challenger. We're going to talk about those in this video. The first of them is that handling isn't any good in the Hellcats. That is easily the most common question I get about Hellcats in particular, and oddly enough, I've had a ton of those questions this week, because even during quarantine, the limited times that I've been able to go out in public, I've had windows rolled down asking questions about this vehicle, even though the Hellcat's been around for a while. When I've stopped at the grocery store, people that I knew were asking me questions about it, people have been Facebook messaging me, etc., asking, does it handle any better than it did before? Well, the truth is, the Hellcat has always handled pretty decently, to be honest. The trouble has always been that the amount of power that we have under the hood can easily overwhelm the rear wheels. And that's an entirely different question, aside from, does it handle well? Generally, when we're talking about handling, we're talking about skid pad numbers, we're talking about track numbers, we're talking about neutral handling tendencies. All of those are really quite good on the Hellcat, and they've gotten even better because now we have a wider body. The best way to describe the Charger and the related Challenger is that these are classic American muscle cars, and arguably the only classic American muscle cars you can still buy new in the US today. I know that there are plenty of Ford and Chevy fans out there that might argue this because, of course, we have a Mustang, we have a Camaro, we have a Corvette, etc., but they're very different vehicles than this. First up, they're not four-door sedans. And if you're taking a look at the Challenger, they're not enormous two-door coupes. Obviously, the Mustang and Camaro are rear-wheel drive. They have available big, powerful V8 engines under the hood. There is, of course, that Ford GT500, which is absolutely insane and thoroughly, thoroughly powerful. But it's just not the same thing as this. It's an awful lot lighter, feels nimbler. It was really targeting European performance vehicles, just like the Chevy Camaro was, because it's based on a Cadillac ATS, a very direct competitor to the BMW 3 Series. But this guy is definitely different. The American muscle car formula can best be summed up by taking a mainstream family sedan, stuffing a much more powerful engine under the hood, and then making subtle tweaks all the way around while retaining an awful lot of that practicality. And that's exactly what we see here. Even when it comes to the overall looks, you'll notice that the front end definitely is more aggressive than the rest of the Charger lineup. However, it's not as crazy as the modifications that we see, for instance, to the Honda Civic Type R. So we do have some hood treatments, but they're not as aggressive as you might think. And unlike many performance vehicles out there, all the ducts and vents that you see on this vehicle are fully operational and fully functional. We don't have any fake cooling ducts or side gills or anything like that going on that doesn't have a task. The vents on the hood are all about getting cold air into the engine compartment and getting hot air out of the engine compartment. So these are not directly cooling intercoolers, they're not ram air chargers, etc. The scoop in the center helps keep the top of the engine cool, whereas the vents on either side are releasing hot air from the engine compartment, primarily from around the radiator. So air comes in, goes through the radiator, and then comes right out those vents. Once upon a time, large rear-wheel drive American sedans roamed coast to coast. Conventional wisdom says that the reason they don't roam coast to coast anymore is because everybody seems to be preferring crossovers or they wanted fuel economy, etc. But I would argue that the injection of insanity into the Charger lineup is exactly why this is the best-selling large sedan in America that's not a luxury sedan. This outsells the all-new Toyota Avalon, it outsells the Kia Cadenza despite two redesigns, it outsells the Nissan Maxima, the Volkswagen Arteon, the Kia Stinger, the Buick Regal, etc. Some detractors might say that the reason for high Charger sales is due to the fleet sales. And we certainly do see some of these vehicles being sold to rental car fleets, and we see a number of them being sold to municipalities as police cars or federal employee transports, etc. Personally, I don't think that the Charger sales success really has much to do with fleet sales. Even if fleet sales of the Charger were about 50%, which is theoretically possible for something like the Dodge Charger, which is used as a police vehicle around the country, that still means the Dodge Charger outsells almost every other entry in this segment. And I think the key reason for that is the amount of bat crap crazy that we find in the Charger. And I'm not just talking about this particular model, I'm also talking about the 6.4 liter V8, the 5.7 liter V8, etc. This is the only V8 option in this segment, and we have not just one, but three different V8s to choose from. I think the other interesting thing going on is that there is still a segment of the American buying public that wants a big sedan. And we just don't have very many big sedans anymore. The Avalon is not that much bigger than a Camry. The Cadenza, not much bigger than an Optima. The Maxima, actually a little bit smaller than the Altima now. The Arteon, not really bigger than the Passat, inside or outside. The Kia Stinger, again, a little bit more Honda Accord-sized. Even Buicks and Cadillacs just aren't as big as they once were, and Cadillac has killed off their big sedan in America. So if you want a sedan that's over 200 inches long, this is one of the very few options. And one of the things I find funny about that is that if we dial the clock all the way back to the early 2000s, there were Chryslers, Dodges, and competitive vehicles that were bigger than this available. Moving around to the rear, you'll again notice that the changes are pretty subtle. We have these functional vents back here that help release pressure that builds up right there in the rear bumper module. Large twin exhaust tips right down there. You'll notice the wider fender flares from this angle as well. And then we have a pretty subtle spoiler up top. No big wing or anything like that. Obviously, the model that we're looking at has these faux carbon fiber stripes all the way around. And these are one thing that I do want to talk about. I don't think you should ever buy a Dodge with the stripes from the factory because these stripes are freakishly expensive. And you could probably have a more customized look done for a little bit less at a shop near you. So stripes, definitely an option that I wouldn't pick. Speaking of the fender flares, I wish that Dodge had given us a new fender rather than just adding on this fender flare right here. We do have a unique bumper up front and a unique bumper in the rear, but the front quarter panel is the same as the rest of the Charger lineup. It's to reduce overall costs, but this doesn't look quite as together as if this had been a new metal component. Filling out those wheel wells, we have absolutely enormous 305 width tires up front. These are some of the widest front tires you'll find on a new car in North America. We have two-piece rotors, huge Brembo brakes there as well. The two-piece rotors are there to help reduce the overall warping in the rotor. They don't specifically aid in cooling. It allows the hat and the rotor itself to float, to be a little bit independent from one another, so that way they can expand and contract at different rates. We also have the three-season tires on this model, not the four-season tires. Now, you can get a Charger with all-season rubber. With 707 horsepower on tap, this 6.2-liter supercharged V8 is the least powerful version of this engine available right now. There's also a 717 horsepower version if you get the Daytona Special Edition of the Charger. Both produce 650 pound-feet of torque. And if you move on over into the Challenger, you can get 797 horsepower out of a modified version of this 6.2-liter V8 engine. We're talking about absolutely insane power levels. But if you want to be a little bit more rational in your family sedan, there's also a 6.4-liter naturally aspirated 485 horsepower engine, a 5.7-liter 370 horsepower V8, or for the really pragmatic in the crowd, there's a 300 horsepower V6 as well. Clearly the V6 is the most fuel-efficient version of the Charger, 23 miles per gallon combined in that model, clearly nothing to write home about, but this model right here drops that down to 15 miles per gallon combined according to the EPA, and if you have too much fun with this, which is pretty darn easy, you can drop that down right into the single digits. However, if you are pretty careful with it, it's not too hard to get 19 or 20 miles per gallon out on the open highway. As you probably know, the Charger and the Challenger are not the only FCA products that get this batshit crazy engine. You can also get it in, of all things, a Jeep Grand Cherokee, and the rumor mill tells us that the Durango might be getting it next, possibly a Ram pickup truck as well. But what a lot of folks out there don't know is that the Grand Cherokee is significantly faster 0 to 60 than this, even though it weighs 800 pounds more, and that's all about traction. 0 to 60 in that Grand Cherokee happens time after time after time after time in 3.2 seconds on regular road surfaces, on a drag strip, on a track, wherever you want to go, not using launch control, foot off the brake pedal, on the gas pedal, 3.2 seconds every time. It is absolutely mind-warping. This guy right here, there's a lot more drama going on, and 0 to 60 times of around 3.8 to 3.9 seconds still requires some concentration, some control on the throttle, etc., because of the amount of power going to the rear wheels. This brings up two points of conventional wisdom. The first one is that this is actively plotting against you and that the Hellcat is some sort of conniving death trap. Well, it is easy to get the rear end to step out on you, and it does require some patience and a lot of control, but it's also amazing how good the electronic stability control systems are in the Hellcat. They can really help rein things back in once you get your foot off the accelerator pedal. But that said, this power does require respect, and let's talk about why the rear end steps out so easily. This engine not only produces insane peak horsepower and torque numbers, it also creates insane low-end torque figures. Remember that this is a supercharged engine, not a turbocharged engine, so we don't have that same kind of lag that we see in turbocharged engines out there. And at low RPMs, 1,000 and below, we have significantly more power than high-output turbo engines, like we would see in a Mercedes-Benz E63 or a BMW M5. By the time 1,500 RPM rolls around, this is producing 575 pound-feet of torque approximately. By the time 2,000 RPM rolls around, over 550 pound-feet of torque. By the time 2,500 RPM rolls around, 580. And this is producing over 600 pound-feet of torque from 2,700 RPM up to about 6,000 RPM. To put that in perspective, BMW's M5 has a high-output twin-turbo V8 engine, but it produces significantly less torque than this, especially below 1,000 RPM. At 1,500 RPM, where this engine is cooking along at 475 pound-feet of torque, it doesn't take a lot to get there because the boost in the supercharger is almost instant. It's not quite instant, but it definitely is an awful lot faster to come on the boil than a turbocharger. That BMW M5 is producing between 225 and 350 pound-feet of torque, somewhere in that range, depending on where the turbo is as far as its boost. And theoretically, that engine will produce 553 pound-feet of torque from about 1,850 RPM up to about 5,860 RPM, 100 pound-feet of torque less, theoretically, than this engine at its peak. That engine then goes on to make over 550 pound-feet of torque from 1,800 RPM on up to about 5,700 RPM or so. But the big point here is the way the engine delivers power. This is more instantaneous, and it is more brutal when it does come on. If you were hoping that a big American sedan with a big engine under the hood would also have a big, spacious interior, then you may be just a teensy bit disappointed. You see, even though this is big for the segment, it has a really long hood because it has to be able to accommodate those large V8 engines under there, and that means that the body ends up being a little bit shorter behind. We also have a roofline that is not as upright as the classic American family sedan. That's what gives the Charger its aggressive looks. But it also means that with this seat bottom cushion all the way on the floor and me in a relatively comfortable seating position, my hair is brushing the ceiling. Keep in mind that I'm 6 feet tall, so if you're taller than I am, you may want to get your Charger without the moonroof. That will give you a little bit of extra headroom. Hopping into the back seat, we find a bench that definitely feels like a classic American sedan. The seat bottom cushion is higher off the ground than we find in something like a Camry or an Accord. That makes it an awful lot more comfortable for an adult like me because my thighs are not quite as far off of the seat bottom. Unfortunately, we don't have the same kind of legroom that we find in some of those mid-sized family sedans. I have about 4.5 inches of legroom left here, but you would find more legroom in something like a Honda Accord. Now, fortunately, we find more headroom in here than we find in some of those options. If I put my head all the way back there towards the headrest, my hair is just barely brushing the ceiling. I have about 1/4 inch left, but my head is not above this fabric portion right here. It's actually right there above the rear window glass. The downside to that, of course, is that on longer road trips, especially in hotter areas, my head does get a little bit baked here in the rear. But aside from that, the rear bench is pretty cushy and, again, comfortable for adults. We also have door panels that are nicely padded back here, soft touch armrests, etc., features that we don't find in all of the competition. With sedans not being as big as they once were, trunks are not as big as they once were either. Now, this is still a pretty practical cargo area back here, but you will find a larger cargo area in some of the competition. And of course, you'll also find more cargo space in something like a Grand Cherokee Trackhawk, or of course, something like a Kia Stinger, which is a liftback. If you were hoping for the classic American body-carrying trunk, then you should know we're probably good for at least 2 people in here, but the cement shoes probably will have to ride somewhere else. Going for a quick spin around the interior, again, you can see that our model has the regular sized moonroof right here, just over the driver and front passenger's heads. Again, I would not get this particular option if you are a taller driver or have a taller front passenger in your vehicle often. You can see right there the step down, how much space that takes out of the roof. Moving over to the door panels, we have a lot of soft touch materials. These are mainly soft touch injection molded components that have then been after stitched to give it the impression of stitched materials. This is a two-tone design that is optional in this trim. Hard plastics down there at the bottom of the door, just as you'd expect. An area where some folks have said, you know, switches were replaced versus the first generation Charger and Challenger. You can see right there over on the door, these are very similar designs to Mercedes switch gear. They were designed to fit in the same spot as the previous ones, even though technically they're not the same part. That's what they mean by quote unquote completely redesigned. Moving over to the dashboard, we find soft touch injection molded materials. And in this model, we have the optional real carbon fiber trim wrapped around this infotainment system. I have to admit that it does look a little bit fake from some angles, but when the light is glistening right on it, you can see that it actually is carbon fiber under that lacquer layer. Over here we have the Chrysler Uconnect 8.4 system. This is not the latest version of Uconnect that was just introduced for the 2021 model year, but you can see it does support Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. But the big change, of course, here for the SRT model are these SRT screens. This is where we would change the drive mode. We have track, sport, custom, auto right over there. We can also click this performance page option, wait for that app to load. We have a lot of different things going on there. We have the engine read out there where you can see power and torque. We have the dyno mode there, which can graph it for you. There's a G-force option. We have gauges right there, and you can click on these gauges, this little icon right there, if I can click on it, and then pop out, and then you can get a little running gauge of that so you can see how hot you get. We have timers. We have the home screen right there, which takes us back to this. The home page is configurable, so if you want to have things like air fuel ratio, your timers over here, you can pick from all the timers the system, and G-force down there, you're able to do all of that. If we head back over to this screen, you'll also notice that we have launch control options there, line lock, things like that, race condition settings right there. Launch control can also be accessed via this one press button right here. That is really handy versus some of the other performance cars out on the market. You then follow the instructions on the instrument cluster, and this will show you the status right there in the infotainment system. We have the dual zone automatic climate control there. You can see that we do have the red key. I think that was a brilliant marketing campaign on Dodge's part to give you color-coded keys that enable you to reduce the power output. So this will operate as a 500 horsepower car if you don't have the red key. We have the T-bar shifter down here, manual mode over to the left, Dodge Brothers logo right there in that little change holder. Over here we have two large cup holders with a roller top. My one complaint is that there aren't too many good places to put a cell phone, although some of those larger phones will fit in that slot. The cable does dangle around a bit. Again, two large cup holders right there, softly padded center armrest, and you'll find the two USB inputs for the infotainment system right in there. Obviously, the overall interior styling is definitely old school or retro, whatever you want to call it, but when we take a look at some of the details, you'll notice that the technology really isn't that far behind. For instance, we have a partial LCD instrument cluster over here on the driver's side. It's controlled via some controls on the steering wheel, and we get far more readouts out of this screen than we see in a lot of the competition. So let's dial through some of them here. You can see all these different performance screens, quarter mile times, braking distances, G-forces, lap timers, lap history, etc. This is a pretty snappy display. We have fuel economy readouts there. You can see that overall fuel economy hasn't really been too bad over the last 160 miles. Keep in mind this is making 700 horsepower. We also have audio readouts, vehicle messages. You can set up certain screen functions, whether you want the temperature readout to be up there in the right-hand corner, etc. We have speed warnings, access to vehicle diagnostics, there's a digital speedometer. Then we have our typical gauge readouts here that we find in other FC vehicles, like tire pressure, coolant, oil pressure, transmission temperature, battery voltage, air intake, engine torque, all that sort of stuff going on there. Although we have seen the same displays in the Charger for quite some time, it's worth noting that they still feel pretty fresh when compared against the competition, because we really don't find that same level of information or control in the instrument cluster or in the infotainment system in really any of the other sedans that are in this theoretical mainstream large sedan category. Moving out to the steering wheel, we find one of my favorite wheels right now. We have a very thick rim, so if you are not a fan of thick rimmed wheels, you should definitely keep that in mind. You can really see how aggressively thick this bottom portion of the steering wheel is, because this portion where it mates to the button modules, etc., is the same thickness as the standard wheel in the Charger. We then get this bulged out section down there at the bottom. We have a flat bottom right there. This is my only dislike for the steering wheel, is we do have this cheesy plastic piece right here, and then we get some very aggressive grips up top as well. Obviously, the first thing you're going to notice about the Hellcat out on the road is the insane amount of power. And as long as you apply it smoothly, it is an awful lot of fun. But again, things do start to go a little hinky in corners, so you really have to plan ahead. This is not the kind of car where if you want to pass someone and you're going 20 miles an hour or so, you floor it first, then steer around them, and then steer back in the lane. No, this is the kind of vehicle where you go to the other side of traffic, then you floor it when legal to do so, obviously, then you floor it, then you pass them, then you return to your lane. You have to have that coordinated series of events, because we have a lot of power. And these roads are not exactly dry yet. It has been raining for the last few days here, so we're definitely gonna try and keep this calm. 0 to 60 in our testing, again, we got just under 3.7 seconds in a pre-production model. In this vehicle, we mirrored about the same 3.7 seconds, 0 to 60. 3.6 seconds should certainly be achievable if you have the right tires on the right surface. And we're talking a slightly more professional surface than the average street out there. The line lock system and launch control are certainly a ton of fun, and they're going to be essential to giving you the best 0 to 60 time if you're on a drag strip and you have slicks on the vehicle. For the rest of us, launch control is probably not going to be the best way to get 0 to 60, especially if you've got the all-season tires on your particular model. Keep in mind, they're not going to have the same kind of grip that we find out of this model. An important thing to keep in mind, and this might blow some of your minds, is that the Hellcats are not about 0 to 60 times. These are about quarter mile times, they're about drag strips, they're about that kind of fun. They're about the insanity of having this much power, this much torque, and only two wheels driven. If you wanted mind-blowing 0 to 60 times, mind-blowing 0 to 30 times especially, then you want a Tesla, or you want a Grand Cherokee Trackhawk, or you want a Porsche Taycan. Those vehicles will give you that absolutely face-warping 0 to 30, 0 to 60 times. This frankly won't. Even on a drag strip, even with launch control, there are options that are going to be faster 0 to 30, 0 to 60. But if we're talking about higher speed acceleration ones, 100 miles an hour on up to the top speed of this, which is nearly 200 miles an hour, this is going to be faster than something like that Tesla Model S. Or if we're talking about insane quarter mile times where we need the extra power to get you from above 30 or 40 miles an hour where the tires are really gripping their best on up to those absolutely insane quarter mile times, that's where we need this kind of power. Thanks to those enormous tires, stopping distances in this model came in at 104 feet from 60 miles an hour back to zero. And this is again the part where folks think that this vehicle can't handle, it can't stop, it's only good in a straight line, it's only good in a drag strip, it's only good in the quarter mile, etc. That is absolutely simply not true. In fact, when it comes to overall 60 to 0 braking scores and skid pad numbers, this does incredibly well when pitted against modern performance luxury vehicles like an M5 or an E63. A 104 foot stopping distance is incredibly short. This is only about 5 feet longer than something like a Honda Civic Type R, which is incredibly lightweight. And although we don't have access to a skid pad, we know folks that do. When it comes to skid pad numbers, this is only 0.02 behind an E63 or an M5. Skid pad numbers are of course a power on figure, and in those situations the M5 and the E63 do have a little bit of benefit from their all-wheel drive system most likely. In neutral handling situations when you are not with your foot on the right pedal, this definitely has a great feel to it out on the road. Unquestionably, this is a big sedan. It weighs over 4,000 pounds. This is not going to feel like an M3 or a C63 AMG, but in terms of overall feel, this really is not far off some of those big performance sedans either. Due to a quirk of scheduling, I had a few days overlap with this vehicle and the Honda Civic Type R. Obviously, two very different kinds of vehicles, but two vehicles that are insane amounts of fun for different reasons. The Honda Civic Type R does handle better than this in the skid pad and theoretically out in real life, but on most tracks in America, as long as we're not talking about really tiny tracks, this is going to obviously be the faster vehicle because the speeds are just gonna be so much faster. Out on a rougher road like we're on here, the adaptive suspension definitely makes the ride more comfortable. Even though this is a big and relatively heavy sedan, and it certainly feels like it out on the road, the suspension is relatively firm. Now, I wouldn't describe the suspension as punishing in any of the drive modes, but if I click over here to the SRT page and then get this over here into the sport or perhaps even the track mode, that's probably the better way to put that, then things definitely firm up, but you can still feel that this is a bigger stand. Still, it doesn't become bone crushing. Here's the thing. With a lot of performance vehicles out there, manufacturers clearly could make them more powerful. If BMW wanted to make a 1,000 horsepower M5, they could definitely make a 1,000 horsepower M5 tomorrow. But these companies also decide that they want to be more rational. They think handling should match the amount of power, and clearly we don't have the technology to make a vehicle pull 1.5 Gs horizontally while we also can give it 1,000 horsepower of thrust. We just don't have those kinds of rubber compounds. The physics just say that that should not happen. But the FCA engineers, on the other hand, all obviously collected into a room and they had this rational discussion, and then they said, forget it. we'll just jam all the horsepower under the hood and stick some wider tires on there. We'll do what we can. The result really explains the character of the Hellcat, because this unquestionably handles well for a big 4,500 pound sedan. It handles well for a Dodge Charger even. This is the best handling version of the Charger by far, but we also get those insane power figures out of it. Now back to some more conventional wisdom. Some folks out there say that the Dodge Charger is nothing more than a 30-year-old Mercedes-Benz E-Class. Some folks say that there is no Mercedes DNA left because it was all excised back in 2011. And others seem to think that for some reason, any Mercedes DNA would be a bad thing. To unpack this, we have to go back in time a little bit. In the 1990s, Chrysler had a very successful front-wheel drive series of vehicles on the LH platform. Now, the LH platform, the Intrepid, the Chrysler 300, etc., those were, interestingly enough, originally intended to be front-wheel drive or rear-wheel drive. Unfortunately, the cash ran out and the rear-wheel drive models never happened. But that meant that when the Mercedes-Chrysler marriage happened, Chrysler was already thinking about making rear-wheel drive vehicles, and they already had some plans in the works. Chrysler was able to send engineers over to Germany, root around in the Mercedes parts bin, and of course, discuss with Mercedes certain synergies that could be applied to their vehicles. Where can we save money by co-developing certain components? And that's how we ended up with the first rear-wheel drive set of these vehicles back in 2004 on the LX platform. Those had suspension components that were directly shared with Mercedes-Benz S-Class models and Mercedes-Benz E-Class models. The rear suspension was derived from an E-Class, the front suspension derived from an S-Class. And yes, some of those designs did date back to the 1990s, the W220 to 1998, the W210 to 1995. With that in mind, back in 2004, Chrysler applied some lightning and released their first Frankenstein's monster. We had a lot of German parts going on, we had a lot of American parts going on. It was wrapped in American styling and an American interior, but it certainly shared a lot of Mercedes componentry. Then in 2011, they gave everything a significant refresh, but here's the way to think about that refresh. If you have a nut and a bolt and they mate together with one another, and then you completely redesign the bolt, but it has to still interface with the nut, then have you really completely redesigned the bolt? And that's what's going on with this generation of vehicles. Theoretically, you could still completely unbolt the rear suspension and then bolt on a Mercedes E-Class suspension from 2002. So this particular argument is a little bit lost in the semantics. The bigger question here is, does it matter? And the answer there is a hearty no. The bottom line here is that even though the Charger shares no components directly with a current generation Mercedes, there is still an awful lot of Mercedes DNA steeped into the Charger, and that's not a bad thing. Now it's time to do our pricing and comparison section just a little bit different. The base price on the Hellcat is $69,995. For all Hellcat models, the wide body kit is standard. So we get the wider stance, we get the wider tires, etc. Again, the summer tires are optional. Those are certainly an option that I would get. Clearly, you could drive this in the snow if you absolutely had to, but I would really recommend that anybody out there that thinks they need all-season tires or winter tires, they probably just need another car for those situations, because again, we get so much power out of this engine that it does get a little bit tricky to control in those low traction situations, even with all the nannies on, even with the power reduced. Now on top of that nearly $70,000, you have to add a $2,100 gas guzzler tax, but there are some discounts going because these guys don't seem to be selling over MSRP anymore. And that puts these at around $93 per horsepower. That is some really inexpensive horse. If you take a look at a BMW M5, they're charging $171 per horsepower. Even something like a Honda Civic Type R, which is value performance in America, that's more per pony than this guy right here. As if you needed any justification for a 700 horsepower car, I also think the Charger is a little bit easier to justify over the Challenger, because with the Challenger, you do have a number of other options. You could get the more handling-oriented Ford Mustang, or of course, high horsepower versions of the Camaro as well. But with this guy right here, there really is no comparison. This may sound really strange, but in my head, the most logical competitor to the Charger here really is something like the Jeep Grand Cherokee Trackhawk. It's the same engine, same power level, but we add all-wheel drive and $17,000 to the price tag. Now, the Grand Cherokee also has some decent deals going on, but it is still going to be notably more expensive than this guy right here. But the Grand Cherokee feels a little bit newer. It feels a little bit fresher on the inside. We have more practicality as well. We have more headroom for the driver. Again, headroom is a little bit limited here. More rear passenger room in reality. It definitely feels a bit more spacious, especially in the headroom department. More cargo room in the back. And oddly enough, faster 0 to 60 times. That model is, I think, the better vehicle for the person that's not going to take the vehicle out on a track. So if you just want absolute batshit crazy 0 to 60 times, if you are using this as a daily driver and you want to have fun with it on weekends on your favorite road, the Grand Cherokee will do things that you seriously think no 5,500-pound SUV should ever be capable of. But it also is still quite practical and easy to live with in some of those adverse situations. The traction is what's going on here. 0 to 60 in 3.2 seconds, absolutely no problem. This guy requires more finesse. This guy's also a little bit more insane and a little bit more crazy, and that is what muscle cars are all about. So, still not the same thing, and that's why there really is nothing else like this. BMW, Mercedes, all the mainline luxury car companies that are after thoroughly insane 0 to 60 times, excellent handling, etc. They're all all-wheel drive because you really need all-wheel drive when we're talking about this kind of power. And so they have made very polished vehicles. Now, some folks out there take that to mean that there is no room for this in the world. And I argue that there absolutely is. This is a special kind of fun. But it also leads to some of these assumptions that we've talked about in this video. For instance, people think that this is insanely heavy. A Mercedes-Benz E63 is only 80 pounds lighter. So if you put a little bit of groceries, a child seat, and a four-year-old in here, this is the same weight as an E63. Depending on how full your gas tank is, this could be the same weight as an E63. We're talking about that little difference. Now, the BMW M5 is a little bit lighter, but it's only 230 pounds lighter. So stick an adult male passenger in the front seat, bang, you're at the same weight as a BMW M5. But what's different about those vehicles is that they're all-wheel drive, and they have the ability to apply that power more easily. So they're more confidence-inspiring. You can apply more throttle in a corner. You can floor it in more situations without the rear end getting stepping out on you, without it getting too squirrely in the back, and that is an awful lot of fun, but it's not the same kind of crazy fun that we see in this. Which is right for you will really depend on what you're looking for. Are you looking for that craziness? Are you looking for the insanity of 700 horsepower to just two wheels? Or are you looking at something that's perhaps a little bit more rational? And if you're looking for something that's a little bit more rational, then I would say Grand Cherokee. If you're looking for something that's a lot more rational, obviously the BMW M5 is there, but it's going to be significantly more expensive. Remember that you could buy one of these and you could buy a crossover for your daily commute when it starts snowing outside for less than a BMW M5. In fact, you could buy a Grand Cherokee with a 5.7 liter V8 and one of these for about the same price as an average configuration BMW M5 or Mercedes-Benz E63. Let me know what you think about all that down there in the comment section below. Find us over at facebook.com/alexnautos, over at Instagram, etc. And I'll see all of you later.